Hi guys, my name is Vivek and this is the second video of the video series SQL interview questions. If you have not watched the first one, I will highly recommend that you watch it as well. I will leave a link to it in the description. This is a refresher video which will really help you if you are appearing for an interview. I have made detailed videos on most of these concepts. If you want to learn these things in detail, I will leave a link to those videos in the description as well. So first, we are going to discuss what is normalization. Normalization is the process of splitting or organizing of data to reduce redundancy and to avoid data anomalies. So if you have a data set that contains some redundant data, you can actually split it into multiple data sets to reduce redundancy and to avoid data anomalies. There are three commonly used normal forms of normalization. The first normal form states that the data set should not contain any multivalued attribute. The second normal form states that the data set should be in first normal form and there should be no partial dependency in the data set. That is, no non-prime attribute of a data set should depend on a portion of the primary key. The third normal form states that the data set should be in second normal form and there should not be any transitive dependency. That is, any non-prime attribute should not depend on any other non-prime attribute of the data set. What is denormalization? Denormalization, as the name suggests, is opposite of normalization, which is merging of two or more data sets for faster retrieval of data while selection in OLAP databases. Denormalization is done usually when the data updates are infrequent and it is helpful in reducing the join complexity because the number of tables in a denormalized dataset are reduced. If you want to learn normalization, forms of normalization and denormalization in detail, I have created separate videos on this. I will leave a link to them in the description. What are views? Views are database objects that do not hold any physical information. They are just metadata. Or we can say they are like a virtual table. Views are created by joining one or more tables, and when we access the view, the underlying query is run every time to return the dataset. The important question is, why do we even need views? There are three main reasons because of which we create views. The first is abstraction. You don't want to display the underlying query and its complexity to every user, so you can hide that by simply creating a view. The second reason is security. Your table may contain columns that hold PII information. By creating views, you can easily choose not to expose these columns to the users. The third and one of the more important reasons is maintainability. When you are exposing your data to another application, and if you decide them to provide a query and they use it at multiple places, if you are changing the underlying table, then the application will have to make that change at multiple places. So the best idea is you create a view. You can change the underlying logic at your end, but the other application will not have to make any changes. What are materialized views? Materialized views are DB objects that hold or stores the output of a query, which is the basic difference with views. Views only hold the metadata, while materialized views hold the actual output of the query. Then why should we create materialized views? We can simply create a physical table, right? Well, populating that physical table will require an ETL process which will have to be scheduled, and it may fail as well. But most importantly, materialized views are read optimized because of a concept called query rewrite. This helps in faster retrieval of data. We need to be careful while using materialized views, because if the underlying table data changes and the materialized views are not refreshed, then we will see old stale data from materialized views. So it is vital, whenever the underlying data changes, the materialized views are refreshed. There are three strategies to refresh materialized views: complete, fast, and force. Whenever you are connecting or joining two tables, it is vital to understand the relationship between them, or for a particular occurrence of a value, how many maximum occurrences can occur in the other table. This is a very vital concept while joining tables, and let's understand it with an example. This is the customer and payment table for an organization that offers lifetime membership of a product on one-time payment. So here, for every customer, we can have a maximum of one row in the payment table. For example, Jane has only one row in payment for the date of January 2019 when she bought this product for $70. Each record from customer table can have at most one record in payment table, and vice versa. This is called one-to-one relationship between tables. The next example states the most common one-to-many or many-to-one relationship. Here we have an organization which accepts periodic payments for the stuff you buy. So one customer can have multiple rows in our sales table. For example, Jane has made multiple payments. So here a customer can have more than one entry in the sales table. This is referred to as one-to-many relationship. Finally, we have many-to-many relationship, where one row from the first table can have multiple occurrence in the second table and vice versa. That is, one row from the second table can have multiple occurrences in the first table as well. Here, Jane is teaching SQL, Python, and Unix, which are also taught by John as well. So a single teacher can teach multiple courses, and the same courses can be taught by multiple teachers as well. So these two tables have many-to-many relationship. And obviously, I've just explained them by one columns. They will have many other columns as well. Now let's discuss 10 basic questions that usually interviewers ask to check if you have actual hands-on experience. Which Oracle version did you use in your project? A lot of people who have not worked on a project find it difficult to answer. Whether you worked on Oracle 11G, 12C, you should be prepared with your answer for this. Which database client did you use to connect to your project? Did you use Toad? Did you use Oracle SQL Developer? What exactly did you use? So you should know this answer as well. What authentication mechanism did you use to connect to your database? So there are two basic authentication mechanisms. One is single sign-on, and other is where you explicitly specify the username and password. So either you can connect with your Windows credential, there you don't have to specify the password, but in most of the cases, you have to explicitly specify the username and password. How did you perform version management? So when we write a procedure, a trigger, or a function, or anything, we usually modify it over time. For that, we keep a version history so that we can go back in time and see what exactly have we changed. Okay, so there are tools for that. Usually organization use tools like SVN or Bitbucket. So you should know what version management tool was used in your organization. How many DB environments you had in your project? this actually confuses a lot of people who don't have hands-on experience, because they learn on a particular database. They do not know that this is not how it works in the actual project. Usually in the project, you have four environment: dev, where the development happens, then SIT, where the testing happens. Then you have the user acceptance testing environment, which is called UAT. And then you have final production. So most of the projects have four, three, or at least two, at least one for test and development and other actual production. So you should specify two, three, or four based on what you have in your project. How many facts and dimensions you had in your project? So this is another very important question where the interviewer wants to check if you have actually worked on a data warehousing project. So if you specify two or three, you should know the name of those dimension tables along with the detail that they contained. For example, if you are talking about retail, you can say that we had an order table, we had an order items table. The order table contains the details of all the orders, while the order items contained the details of the items that were ordered. Okay, then you are saying, if you are saying five dimension tables, you should know the dimension tables that you had in your project. For example, region, employee, customer, all that good stuff, right? You need to be prepared with those answers. How did you promote your code between environments? This is another important question. We have our code development environment dev. How do we promote the code from dev to SIT and so on? What level of dimension history did you maintain in your project? So this is another very important question. If you understand the concept of slowly changing dimensions, you know that dimensions usually change over a period of time. Did you maintain SCD1? Did you maintain SCD2? If you have actually worked on a project, you will be able to answer it immediately. And you should know, if you are saying SCD1, that what exactly is SCD1, what exactly is SCD2. So you should have an answer in mind and you should know what are these slowly changing dimensions. Which software development model did you use in your project? Did you use waterfall? Did you use agile? If you have used agile, definitely mention that. The adoption of agile model has considerably increased over the last few years. So if you know and have worked on agile, you will have an added advantage. How frequently you had your releases? So a lot of people who have not worked do not understand the concept of releases. If you had a monthly release, a quarterly release, or that kind of stuff, right? You should know these basic answers well in advance, because a lot of time, apart from your technical experience, the interviewer tries to gauge if you have actual project hands-on experience or not.